Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man la. Rabbi shahli sadri wa yassirli amri wa hlul 'uqdatan min lisani yafqahu qawli. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My name is Afan Siddiqui. I'm from YM, New Jersey, specifically YM South Jersey, and I will be serving as the moderator today. I hope and pray that everyone is doing well, staying at home, safe and healthy, and has enjoyed and taken a lot out of the sessions thus far. On behalf of young Muslims and ICNA, I'd like to welcome you all to this online symposium and to the third session of today. Ustadah Ieasha Prime, who is the next speaker. Ustadah Ieasha Prime studied Arabic and Quran at the Fajr Institute in Egypt. Later, she attended Dar al-Zahra, an Islamic university for women, where she studied Aqidah, Fiqh, and Hadith. She is currently the executive director at Baraka Incorporated, empowering women and youth with the foundations of Islam. And she will be talking to us about when Allah changes our plan.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Can you hear me properly? Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah. I want to start off, Allah Azza wa Jal reminds us in Quran, in Al-Imran. He says, wa makaru Allah, wallahu khayrun makirin. That they plan and Allah plans, and Allah is the best planners. From this very moment, we recognize the truth of Allah Azza wa Jal in the Quran and His relationship to us. From this ayah, we recognize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not just giving a general message that applied 1400 years ago, but that He's giving us a message that is applying to our lives right now, even in our individual circumstances. I want to thank ICNA so much for having this conference, even pushing forward and saying we've got to connect to our community no matter what, that whatever circumstances Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us, we're going to continue to do our work to connect the creation to the creator. And so this is something that Sheikh Yasser right before us was mentioning this, right? And so looking at our plans, looking at this ayah, I want to say to you congratulations, because I'm sure we were all planning in order to be in the DMV area and to attend this conference and to wear our nice clothes and to go to the bazaar and to be with our friends and to have laughter and, you know, do all kinds of halal food and as well as support the halal economy. That's what I call it when I go to the bazaar. And subhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I have a different plan for you. That I, this year, am going to test you with something that you've never been tested with before. And I want us to look at when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us something that He has never given us before, it happens on both sides. Whenever there's a matter that happens low, there is a matter that's happening high. Whenever there's something that's happening on the right, there's also something that's happening on the left. And so we may look at this moment as something like we are being tried, but what is it that's coming next? So I want to talk about this as it relates to this particular verse. During this month of Sha'ban, of course, we're constantly reminded to think of our beloved Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam. What would he do? What would he say? What about the trials in his life? How did he respond? And when we look, subhanal khaliq, at the example of him going to visit At-Ta'if, when he went, he had a plan. His idea was this particular time, we know that his uncle Abu Talib had passed away. And when his uncle had passed away, the Prophet ﷺ was made a plan that him and Zayd ibn Harith, they would go into Ta'if in order to possibly make an alliance, to make a connection with those in Ta'if, in order to have some kind of relationship that there might be an alliance of protection and of some mutual benefit. But when the Prophet ﷺ arrived, his plans were absolutely changed. Things did not go at all like he thought. As a matter of fact, it went the exact opposite. His hopes is that they would open their hearts, that Allah al-Fatah would have opened their hearts. They would have open minds, or at least they would be cordial to some type of conversation, or at least cordial to the possibility of an alliance. And yet when he arrived, not only did they ridicule him, but they also, as he was, you know, they sent him quickly leaving from the city. And as he left, they sent a group of the we would say the thug, the low lifes of the society, in order to throw stones at him, to spit on him, and to continuously pelt him until our beloved Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam would begin to bleed so profusely that his blessed sandal would become soaked in his own blood. But yet, in this moment of his plans being completely changed, and I want us to think about this moment for the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, that he's on a mission, not just for himself. He's on a mission for Allah. He's on a mission to spread this deen. So many of us say, Ya Allah, I'm someone who's practicing this deen. I'm someone, Ya Rabbi, who I pray, I fast, I read my Quran, I recite my adhkar, I'm wearing my hijab, I'm struggling in this society. Ya Rabbi, how could I be tried like this? Ya Rabbi, how is it that I'm being tested with this? And there are a multitude of trials that we're all experiencing inside of our own homes. And the issue for us is not necessarily what the trial is, but how we respond. This is what we're charged with. We're charged with our response. And so the beloved Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, when he's confronted with Angel Jibra'il and the Angel of the Mountains, they give him the option. Oh, Messenger of Allah, if you want, we will cause these mountains to collapse onto these people and crush them. And the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, Allah didn't send me to curse people. He sent me as rahmatul alameen. He sent me as a mercy to mankind. And that is the mission that I will continue. And he continued to make dua for these people. I ask us at this particular time, as that we are people of risalah, we're people of a mission. As Sheikh Yasser just reminded us before that this is not the time for us to become complacent. It's not the time to say, well, I was planning, you know, I had social plans, I had educational plans, I had graduation plans, I had family plans, there were wedding plans that got interrupted, and yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has replaced my good plans with this social isolation, with this being on lockdown, with sickness, and even loss, subhanal khaliq, that many of us are experiencing fear, we're experiencing grief, we're experiencing feelings of loneliness, all the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us that shaitan would threaten us with, that he would threaten us with loss of life, he would threaten us with fear, with grief, and that he would threaten us with the diminution of fruits, which is what? That we've been working hard for something and we're not able to see the result. But anytime, just like when we breathe, there's a moment of constriction. We're out of breath, and then there's a moment of expansion. That anytime Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us a constriction, it is for a reason. It is for some of the best reasons. And anytime, subhanAllah, Allah has a plan, know that there are two things that are expected from us. There are two types of will in divine decree. In divine decree, Allah gives us free will, right? And the next one after free will, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives Allah's will. There are times Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows us to plan and to enact our plan, to execute our plans, to do exactly as we had hoped for, to move about our daily life, however we choose. And yet, how grateful are we for those moments when we are you know, just moving about our life so freely. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the will and the strength and the power to do so. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enacts his power and lets us know exactly who is in control, when he has a moment where he is letting us know huwa al-akbar wa huwa al-azim, that he is the greatest, that he is the most majestic and the omnipotent, that he is the most powerful, the response that then must come from us is a response of la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, that there is no might and no power except that from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what does the believer then do? They submit even more. It's not only that they submit begrudgingly. It's not only that they submit saying, well, I've got no other choice. That the believer begins to submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a happy heart, saying, Ya Rabbi, you have called me to your worship. Allahu Akbar. Ya Rabbi, you have literally called me to slow down, to stop, to remember you, to reflect, to take time, right? To repent. You have called me to recognize and to reflect upon my own weaknesses, out of my own lack of resources, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did. And when this happened to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there were two gifts, two expansions Allah gave him. The first one he gave him was Suratul Yusuf. He gave him Suratul Yusuf after Ta'if as a gift. Now we might look at this and say, wow, what did Suratul Yusuf, he gave him more knowledge, he gave him, you know, is that the reward for such hardship? Absolutely. Because this revelation is a reminder of some very serious things. One of the things that it reminds us of is we look at Yaqub alayhi salam. We look at when something that is beloved to him is removed from him. That it doesn't mean that he doesn't experience some sadness. Just like some of us will lose loved ones or friends, or like we have lost what we love the most, we have lost the power over our own time. That we have lost some of the power over our own movements. But also, subhanAllah, doesn't mean you won't feel something. But does that sadness keep you away from your Lord? Does it keep you from progressing and moving closer to Him? And then, of course, what is the situation with Yusuf? What does it teach us? It teaches us about the seductive powers of the dunya. It teaches us about, subhanAllah, what is it that Yusuf said, I prefer. When sometimes it's not us chasing the dunya, it's true. Sometimes it's not us going behind the dunya. Just like Yusuf, the dunya is actually chasing him. In the case of Zulaikha in the Quran, Yusuf is actually innocent of this. But yet Shaitan and Zulaikha, they're after him. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts him in seclusion. But in that seclusion, he doesn't stop. He says, I even prefer this, Ya Rabbi. I prefer this moment to be with you. I prefer this khalwa over this constant having to fight my own nafs and having to run away from the dunya, subhanAllah. He said, I prefer this. So in our case, what were we saying? Ya Rabbi, whatever state you give me, I'm content with your decree. I submit full-heartedly, right? I submit with a happy heart. I'm happy to be in connection to those who are my family, right? In order to repair my relationships, in order to be closer to them, in order to recognize our struggles more closely and have the opportunity to rectify our affairs. Right? This is something that, subhanAllah, we're able to look at in this situation. I want us to look at the next section. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us in Quran al-Kareem, Allahu waliyu lilladhina amanu yukhrijuhum min adh-dhulumati ila nur. That Allah says, Allah is the ally of those who believe, and He brings them from darkness into light. Now, most of us are not willing to look at what kind of darkness was in my life? That in this moment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in His generosity, is saying, I'm going to pull you away from that. I'm going to pull you into a different place. I want to bring you into a different mindset. I want to bring you to a higher level of spirituality. I want to give you an opportunity for ascension. Not because I'm angry with you, not because necessarily you have done something wrong, but because now is the time to elevate you. Now is the time to elevate your rank, which was the second gift that the Prophet sallallahu wasallam alayhi, that he received after Ta'if, he received the ascension, right? And through the ascension, he goes through different phases. He passes by Adam, who has a trial with his children. He passes by Isa and Prophet Yahya, who has a trial with their ummah, who has a tribe with their community, right? They're facing the worst type of Islamophobia. He passes through Idris, who's facing problems from his own people. They don't want to change. They want to hold on to some of their old ways that are different from Allah. It's a cultural struggle that they're in. He passes with Ibrahim, who has an issue, Subhan al Khaliq, of course, with his father, and that's at the highest level, right? He has an issue with his father who doesn't believe. And of course, we know that he passes by Musa, who faces so many challenges. But one of the things that we learn in Surah Taha, right, is that we learn that what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was teaching Musa in this, he was teaching him how to have victory over fear and anxiety. So what are the two things in my closing that we need during this time that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the opportunity to grab hold to some gifts and take with us? As one day we will go back into the dunya, just like Yusuf is freed, just like the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he leaves Ta'if, he's ascended, and then he comes back to the dunya to do the work. Ista'anu billah bisabri wasalah. That you've got to hold on, you've got to have, seek help through Allah with patience and in prayer. How are you going to do that? With him on aynat. You've got to have forbearance and you've got to be steadfast in this patience. And so when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala interrupts our plans, what we recognize is la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Allah is the greatest of planners, and I'm happy to submit to whatever His decree is, because whatever Allah has chosen me is the best choice for me in this dunya and the akhirah, and we must do our best to make the most benefit of our time and this special moment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us. So jazakumullahu khair. Congratulations for being those who are holding on to the rope of Allah by tuning in to this particular session. Afwan minkum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Jazakallah khair, Ustadah Ieasha Prime. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from you and reward you immensely for your efforts.